Hey, we're Anna and Jennifer Smith with Marriage After God,
helping you cultivate an extraordinary marriage.
And today we're going to be talking about how to study the Bible as a family. Hey, thanks for joining us today. I, as always, want to invite you to subscribe to our channel by hitting the little red button. And also next to the red button is a bell. You can click that and that will give you notifications every time we upload a new episode.
Also, throughout this episode, we're going to be talking about how to study the Bible as a family. And if you have any resources, books, family devotionals that you have found to be very impactful in your family, please share them in the comments so that other people can find those resources. So today we're going to be talking about how to study the Bible as a family, and I love letting you guys know that this was a question that you guys had. So we hear you, and we hope to answer this question with some of our own personal experience with studying the Bible as a family, and we're going to start with scripture. So Aaron, why don't you start with that?
Yeah, so we're going to start in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 through 9, and it says this: "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them a sign on your hand, and they shall be as a frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates." So we just wanted to start off with this scripture because it's a kind of a foundational verse for us in just the understanding of what the Bible, what the Word of God, what His commandments, His precepts, His laws are in our home. And he all the way back in Deuteronomy, when God has given all the laws and He's continually giving the laws throughout the Old Testament, God tells them, "Hey, teach your children the things I tell you to teach them. Teach your children the commandments." And so this is a pretty good verse to just wrap your mind around. Instead of it being like, you know, once a day, or we have 5 minutes a day here, or we do it on Sundays, we do this. It's a daily, moment by moment lifestyle that we get to live. So the first thing we want to talk about when it comes to this verse and how we can look at studying the Bible as a family and what it means is this word diligent. It says, "You shall teach them diligently to your children." And so
I looked up the definition and it says careful and persistent work or effort.
Yeah. So when you think of diligent in our home, what does that look like? Is it like, every so often, or when the need comes up, or like, oh, we need to get back into it, or what is that
like? I feel like it's more of a being mindful and being an intentional thing. So it's, you know, finding those opportunities all throughout the day to be in the Word, to share, you know, different biblical concepts or principles with the kids. It's like this says, being careful and persistent, work or effort. It's actually putting forth that work to find those opportunities and to share and meditate on the Word with your children and with your spouse.
So instead of it being a whimsical, like, well, sometimes we get it, or when we have inspiration, we open up the Bible.
Or holidays, special holidays.
Or on special occasions. It's more of a intentional, consistent
daily pursuit
and diligent. You know, when you think about anything you want to get good at in life, diligence is the first word I think of. Like, if you want to get good at your position at your work, or a certain sport, or if you're trying to learn a new skill,
you have to become familiar with it, you have to try and understand it, you have to try and teach it,
which all of those things fall under diligence. It's a continuing, whether I'm like struggling, oh man, like I'm going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
I don't have all the time I need today. We're going to make it work. So the diligent part of this is a really important. It's one of the reasons why when you read through the Old Testament and you see Israel, the children of Israel, they're following God. And then the next generation, it says they turn their hearts from God. And then it says the next generation is following God. And then the next generation's, a lot of the reasons that happened throughout the Old Testament, when the relationship that the children of God had with Him, was because the parents were not diligent in teaching their children the Word of God.
And we can't deceive ourselves in thinking that we're being faithful by following God in the wee hours of the morning before our kids wake up and not ever talking about it with our children, right? Because we can think we're in the right with God because we're reading His Word and we're praying and we're actively pursuing that relationship with Him, but we're not teaching our children.
That was actually something that I got convicted on last year, middle of last year. I realized that all the times I was opening the Word of God,
it was without the kids.
Was when the kids weren't around watching me do it.
Yeah.
They couldn't see me visually open up my Bible. And then when I was reading the Word of God in front of them, guess where it was? Mm. It was on my phone.
Oh.
So all they see is me on my phone. They don't know I'm reading the Bible.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying reading the Bible on the Word of, on the, reading the Bible on the phone is a bad thing. But I think it's not as effective or powerful in this whole idea of diligence with our children, because they're not actually seeing me open this, the physical Word of God, the Bible.
Yeah.
All they do is, all they're seeing is me be addicted to my phone.
Mm-hmm.
And so instead of encouraging them to open the Bible, I'm encouraging them to hold a phone.
Mm.
So,
or doing it away from them.
Or doing it away from them. So not, I mean, we definitely need time away from them in the Word of God. But the diligence part is, I'm diligently making sure that they see the Word of God open. They see us reading it, and then we're reading it to them, and we're explaining to them and teaching them it on a diligence, not whimsically, not haphazardly, not when, you know, when the timing's right. It's something that we try and do daily to the best of our abilities. And I feel like that's what diligence means.
Hey everyone, we just wanted to take a quick break and just say thank you so much for joining us on this week's episode.
And we also wanted to give your marriage a little dare. Jennifer and I wrote two books called 31 Prayers for My Husband and 31 Prayers for My Wife. And we have this little challenge where you get our books and you take 31 days to pray every single day through the book for your spouse with your spouse.
Thousands of couples have already gone through this, and they've left so many reviews explaining how these prayers have transformed their marriage.
And so we just wanted to dare your marriage. If you're interested in taking the challenge, please go to marriageaftergod.com/challenge at the end of the episode. So I just want to encourage you, you know, listening, if you aren't diligent in the Word of God, in your own walk, if you're not opening this up daily, if you're not just reading it and just trying to figure out, you know, what the Spirit has for you to learn from it and what God has for you to learn from it, this is the Word of God. This is what we base our entire life and faith on, is this. If you're not in it, in your, if you're not diligent in yourself, you can't possibly, you know, hope to be diligent with your children.
Mm-hmm.
Would you agree?
Yeah.
This is something that I struggle with, you know, being daily in the Word of God. So I just want to encourage you to be diligent in your, for yourself, getting in the Word of God.
Yeah. I also want to encourage those listening who may not have a family, but it's just you and your spouse. All of what we're going to talk about today still applies to you. So don't think you're getting out of this.
Yeah. The practice starts before the children.
The practice actually starts before the children come. And you can easily, your family right now is your spouse. And so you can easily jump into studying the Bible together as a couple. And that should be happening. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit later. But I just want to encourage those listening, like, this message is still for those of you who are without children too.
Yeah. So we just talked about being diligent. Just this, it's an intentional and continual pursuit that you're just trying, like, okay,
you're
I have a few minutes here. I'm gonna show the kids the, I'm gonna open it up. I'm gonna read it. I'm gonna make it out. I'm gonna read it out loud. Mm-hmm. And then on my own, I'm gonna diligently be in the Word of God and teach it to myself.
Mm-hmm.
But that leads right into this next part of this scripture. And it says, "And you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise."
Mm-hmm.
So we go from the diligence of, like, just that continual and persistent and intentional pursuit of getting into the Word of God as a family.
Mm-hmm.
We get this picture in Deuteronomy. It's a command, actually, for the fathers, for the families, to be like, hey, you need to do this. Is it's not, like you said, it's not just Sundays. Like, oh, on Sundays, we got in the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't really fall under, you know, talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way.
Or when you lie down.
When you lie down and when you rise.
That's like a constant, continue.
That's a daily. That's saying, so what's an example of when you talk in your house? It says talk with it in your house.
Yeah, I think that, I feel like you're really good at when we're talking or having conversations with the kids or something comes up, there's an event that, that happens between the kids, you bring in God's word and you teach them from it. I remember, we may have shared this already, but when Elliot was having a hard time with his sister, you made them memorize Luke 6:31. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. And so being able to remind the kids and again, going back to the finding those opportunities just throughout the day to remind them of what God's word says so that it's not just you're doing what daddy tells you or you're doing what mommy tells you.
Mm-hmm.
You're actually encouraging them to do what God tells them to do.
Right. Because my words are not as powerful as God's words.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the other thing is, like, when I taught them Luke 6:31, I've always known the golden rule, you know, do unto others as you have them do unto you. I didn't know it was Luke 6:31. It actually says it in other Gospels too, in different ways. But because I had the my children memorize it.
It helps you.
I memorized it. So forever I will know Luke 6:31 is do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Yeah. The golden rule.
There's also other opportunities. You know, when you're playing outside and the kids are rolling around in the grass, just being able to tell them, like, do you know who made that? You know, they talk about the sky. Kids are always being observant to things around you. Oh, look at that bird. Look at that dog. Whatever. Yeah. You could talk to them about who created that and bring in God to every aspect of your life. And I feel like that's what Deuteronomy
is
saying.
A good verse for that is in Romans when it says that God's invisible attributes are made known in visible nature.
Yeah.
And we could just, you might feel like, well, I don't know all those scriptures, but here's the thing. When you're diligent and when you do it.
And you become familiar with it.
And you'll slowly start becoming more and more familiar with the word of God.
Yeah.
And guess what? Our children will as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it may be on a different level, maybe on a different scale and a different timeline, but they will start to absorb the things that you are constantly reading. And as you play them out in real life, and that one moment when you have a perfect, physical application, like they're playing with something and you're like, hey, you know, actually, that reminds me of that thing we read the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And then boom, it's in their mind forever because they've just associated this tangible illustration with a spiritual thing.
Yeah. There's other ways that we also bring in scripture, and that's through small Bible studies. I have an older book called Little Visits with God that sometimes when we're at the table, I'll bring it out and it walks you through a story, but then also walks you through some scripture and some questions that you can ask the kids. And so just finding other supplements too that will encourage their faith and encourage them to look back to what God tells them through scripture.
And it goes into the, you know, talk when you're sitting in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up, having not just the Bible, but other things that all reference the Bible and talk about the, like children's books and little prayer books.
We have a rhyming Bible. And I was joking with Aaron the other day that it's not very scriptural because it's not word for word for the Bible, but it tells the same story just through rhyme. And it's actually really beautiful. But it's just another way for the kids to be familiar with what God's word says,
which is essentially the idea of meditation.
Yeah,
the Bible's version of meditation, not New Age meditation, but where we're constantly filling our minds
with
and mulling over the Word of God.
Yeah,
and so there's all the different ways that you can do it in every aspect. You know, when you're in the home, when you're walking, you know, during the day, when you're laying down, when you're rising up.
Yeah,
the laying down portion is like, you know, we pray with our kids before bed, and oftentimes we remind them of things that we learned in
the
Bible, or situations where discipline had to happen, and we're like, hey, remember what God says, and you know, what's the fifth commandment? We remind them all the time.
A little Olive, she's almost three, and she goes, honor your mama and dad.
Yeah.
So cute.
So the next part of this verse.
It's a little weird.
It is a little weird. We actually discussed whether we're going to read it or not, but our heart is that we actually just want to read stuff, even if it's hard, and we'll try and navigate it with you. It says, you shall bind them, this verse 8 in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It says, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. In Jewish culture, they actually, the rabbis take this very literally, and they have these boxes that they'll wear on their foreheads between their eyes, and it has little scriptures in it. And we're not going to go there. I don't think that's exactly what God meant by this. I don't know also. But what this made me think of, this idea says, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. The picture I got from this, and I could be totally wrong, but I think it's applicable, is this Bible, if it's in my hand, is a sign.
It's a visible, tangible sign.
It's not over there. It's not in a drawer.
Tucked away on a shelf.
It's a visible sign that this word of God is important to me, and then I have it, and then I'm willing to read it. So, and the other idea that it's a frontlets between my eyes, that it's always between my eyes.
You're actually reading it.
I'm actually reading it. It's actually something that I focus on. Mm-hmm. It's not just this ancillary thing that is sometimes a part of our life. Mm-hmm. It is a very important part of our life. It's between my eyes. And so I thought a good way of illustrating this is my Bible, our Bibles, are on our nightstands. They're on our right
Kitchen
here.
Table.
They're actually right where you see this is
usually
most of the time
at.
Where it's at.
Yeah.
It sits right here, and either it's open to the thing I'm reading or it's closed, but it's always visible. My kids know we have Bibles and they're always open.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like the scripture, the encouragement is your Bible like on a shelf somewhere hidden And you actually forget about it?
Do you know where your Bible is?
Yeah, do you know where your Bible's at? Is it visible in the home? Is it a centerpiece in the home? Not as a ornament, a decoration, but it's actually a... Like, this is... It could get water on it. Mm-hmm. It could get messy. It can get dirty. The kids see it. They can touch it. It has to be moved when we want to use this area.
Yeah.
So I thought that this was a great way to illustrate it. Again, I could be wrong in the exact interpretation of this, but I feel like the application of the principle is that it's visible. It's a sign in our homes. It's in my hand.
And you're focused on it.
And it's between my eyes. Yeah. It's between our eyes. It's between my kids' eyes. They always see it. Mm-hmm. When I'm sitting at the breakfast table, it's there and we're reading from it.
And what's great about that is they actually become familiar with it. Even at a young age, Elliot was... you would say, okay, we're going to read Proverbs today. And he would know to go right to the middle of the Bible and flip it open. And sure enough, most of the time he would land in Proverbs. Yeah. And he was so excited about that. But getting them familiar too with the way that it sounds and the way that it feels and just becoming familiar with this is an important aspect of their learning.
Yeah, our pastor always encouraged us to get familiar with the geography of the Bible.
Yeah.
And you know what, sadly? Many, many, many Christians are not familiar with the geography of the Bible. They don't know what's New Testament or Old Testament. They don't know where, Deuteronomy is at. They don't know where Jeremiah is at. They don't know where Psalm is at, Proverbs, Job. They don't know what the minor prophets are. The New Testament, the order of it. I still have a hard time memorizing the order of the books, but getting familiar with it as a family. So we're going to get into some more practical things, but as an example, when I read to the kids, I ask them what book we're reading in.
Mm-hmm.
And because they hear the name over and over and over again, they start to remember.
Yeah.
And then I say, what's the first book in the Bible?
Mm-hmm.
And then Olive says,
Genesis.
Yeah, Genesis. It's really funny. So getting familiar with it. So that's kind of where I went with this is you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, that it's always at hand and that it's a front that's between your eyes, that it's always in focus. It's always visible in the home and not just visible, but used.
Yeah.
So, and that brings us to the next part of the scripture. And it says, you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates.
So how we interpret this one is just that you put scripture up, whether you go to Hobby Lobby and get a cool sign or have, like we've shared this before, but having a chalk wall in your house, which we've seen before. We have a chalkboard wall.
We have one right in the kitchen.
I had these old wooden squares. They were pretty large, almost like pallet wood.
Mm-hmm.
And I just painted them all and wrote the Ten Commandments on them. And I stuck them in the kids' room and we go over them every day. And so it's just a great way for verses, God's word, to be visible so that you can be reminded of it, so that your kids can be familiar with it.
So in Jewish culture, they actually take this super literal and they on their doorposts. They have this little metal gadget and it's got inscriptions on it in Hebrew and it's got rolled
scripture
up scripture.
On the inside of it.
On the inside of it. Mm-hmm. But the idea is that it says on your gates too, so that we have scripture visible and it's in our faces constantly. So we read it. It's easy for us to memorize. Another example, we have a lot of friends that they put sticky notes on their mirrors. So when they're brushing their teeth, they're like memorizing scripture.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that it's walking us through diligence. It's a moment by moment, hour by hour, minute by minute focus. It's just a part of every aspect of our life. When we're talking about physical fruit, we're mentioning the fruits of the Spirit. When we're talking about food, we're remembering what Jesus said, that we don't live by bread alone, but every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a part of our life. Mm-hmm. It's not, it's actually all of our life.
Yeah.
Not a part of our life, I meant to say. And a way of doing this is that we have the Word of God in our home.
Yeah.
On walls and on, painted on boards and on our mirrors and on our doors and hanging on our walls. So we walked through Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9 to give us kind of a biblical and scriptural foundation of what it might look like in our homes. That it's not just a Bible study, a once a week, once a day type thing, but it's actually a lifestyle. And so what we want to do now is we want to just transition and we want to talk about some actual practical things that we implement. That you guys might be able to implement as well.
For a specific Bible study, if you did want to walk your family through a very specific time, either during the day or during the week, this is an idea that you might be able to do. So what we do is every morning, we try and do this every morning, and there's sometimes here and there that we don't get to. But what we do is Aaron leads it. So dad leads it, and we usually sit in the couch. The older two kids, who's 5 and 3, sit in these little camping chairs that we got for them.
Which we use at church also, so it's practice for them.
It is practice for that too. And so Elliot has his Bible that he tries to follow along with. He'll go to the same book and then just kind of, he doesn't know how to read yet, so just playing around with.
He does try and recognize words now that he's learning.
Yeah.
So he's like, oh, is this God?
Yeah. And so we would recommend that, you know, maybe ages 3 and up have their own Bible that they can sit with during that time. But they even have other really cool resources out there, like little prayer books or board book Bible books that even the younger kids can mm-hmm. have. But so our youngest is 1 year old and he sits on a blanket with some toys. And so that way that they're still quiet and the whole family can engage together. They just obviously aren't probably paying
attention. He's learning to participate. In other ways. Yeah, he's learning self-control. He's learning, you know, to be still.
Right. So currently we're going through chronologically. So we started in Genesis and we're just moving through the Bible together. How many chapters do you think? Once a day? Chapter a day?
Usually I'll read one chapter. Sometimes it's less if it's like a super long chapter, but and sometimes it's more. But for the most part, it's a chapter.
Okay.
And then we...
Yeah, so usually when we all sit down as a family, you will lead with some questions mm-hmm. referring back to the day before. So like you said earlier, what chapter in the Bible are we in? Yeah. Giving the kids an opportunity to engage right before we actually get into the word. You know, maybe you ask them, well, what happened yesterday? What did we read about? And so that's really cool. And the kids usually are pretty good. We've been surprised by Olive, who's almost 3. We've been surprised by her answering.
She remembers a lot, yeah.
Some of the questions, and sometimes it seems like she's not paying attention at all, and then she answers these questions, and I'm like, wow, you knew that.
So just an encouragement it's not super complicated. I don't have this list of like super deep questions. I just make up questions as I go, and oftentimes they're simple geographical, like, hey, what did we read yesterday, or what book did we read yesterday, and you know, Genesis, Exodus. Well, what's the first book in the Bible? Things that I like to recall also mm-hmm. and learn. I ask them, what's the second book in the Bible? And they're learning because we're in the second book, Exodus. Yeah. I'll say, who's the main character of this book? Mm-hmm. Because we mentioned the name Moses over and over and over again in Exodus.
Or when you were talking about the Red Sea, you know, who was chasing them? You know, the Egyptians.
Yeah, things that are really short. Yeah, they're not super deep and theological, but you know what it does? My kids know what Moses or what Exodus is about.
Yeah.
They know that the main character is Moses. They understand that and Elliot will be like, oh, it's about the Israelites leaving Egypt, mm-hmm. escaping Egypt. And I ask him questions about Pharaoh. Did you think that was nice that he did that? Simple, simple questions. This is not overcomplicated. And actually, I learn the books better that way, just by reading it and asking simple questions to my kids. I don't know about you, but I learn by teaching. And even though I'm not teaching deep theological stuff, I'm learning a lot about the Bible. And you know what? My kids are learning it.
We just wanted to take a quick break to ask you, if you are enjoying this content, would you please leave a star review and a comment review? This helps us spread the word about Marriage After God and just all the episodes that we have to offer. And we would love just to get that reach out there. So please, again, if you have a moment, just take that time to leave a star review and a comment review for us. Thank you so much and enjoy the rest of the episode. And sometimes they have questions that they get to ask and we get to answer for them.
Sometimes.
So it's just a really good time to engage with the family, and then them learning self-control to be quiet while dad's mm-hmm. reading out loud, mom and dad following along in the word. They get to see us in the word.
Yeah.
They're in the word. It's just a really great opportunity for us as a family. That's how we study the Bible. And then we always try and end in prayer. So as we read the Bible, I want you to share a little bit from your perspective when you are leading in that way, because it's new for you too. I mean, you've been doing it for a while now, but it's still new to you. So just to encourage those who might be jumping in with a Bible study like this, are there parts of the Bible that you skip over for, you know, our kids being so young, or is there an age appropriateness to it?
Yeah, we're trying to be careful navigating, as you know, because you could be reading through Exodus and Genesis and some of these Old Testament books, and there's tons of really adult content.
Yeah.
You know, things that you're not going to necessarily want to mention to your kids, depending on their age range. So what we'll try and do is I'll skim quickly through. I won't like deeply read into it, but I'll be reading. And if I feel like it's about to mention something that I'm like, I don't know if my kids are ready to hear this, I'll just skip right over it.
Yeah. And I'm sure as our kids get older, maybe taking those older ones aside and saying, hey, I skipped over this earlier, but I want to sit down and talk to you about it.
Yeah, or when they get older and we get back to that, I might just read through it. Yeah. And if they have questions about it, they'll be at a point where I can actually explain to them.
Yeah.
And they'll understand. Mm-hmm. But depending on their age, I just, I don't overthink it. I don't overcomplicate and say, oh, I need to read every verse. Right. I'll read, because here's the thing, they're getting used to me being in the Word of God.
Yeah.
They're being used to reading the Word of God. They're not, I'm reading things that are sometimes a little boring. Now,
okay, speaking of that, I got to ask, so just to help everyone understand, what do you feel about like your inflection, your voice, and how you present the Word?
Yeah, so I'm going to mention a book that I've been reading. It's called Spiritual Disciplines for a Christian Life. And it goes through spiritual disciplines, prayer, reading the Word of God, things like that. And in the reading the Word of God section, he gave this really awesome encouragement. And he said, practice reading the Word of God out loud, and also practice reading it with voice changes and inflections and making it sound exciting, because it actually helps you retain what you're reading more. And it makes those listening enjoy it more.
Yeah, I feel like our kids, when they get older, are going to have a positive perspective of the Bible and of the Word. It's not going to be something that's boring. They're going to remember, well, Dad got really excited about that. Yeah. And so they're going
to
be excited.
So when Moses is going to the burning bush and God says, remove your sandals.
You get all like in the.
I try and whenever it comes to like God speaking, I try and make it sound big. And I'm not the greatest at it, but I try.
You're good.
But you know what? It's crazy. It's actually helping me be a better reader.
Yeah.
Overall, like I'm actually, I don't know if you've noticed. I feel like I can read better. Because when you read silently, you can read fast. Mm-hmm. But when you read out loud, it causes you to slow down. Mm-hmm. And when you read with voice changes and inflections and tone changes and all that to make it sound more exciting, you have to actually slow down even more and you get better at reading. So it's a good practice and it makes my kids enjoy it better. So real quick, just going back to what you were mentioning about the reading everything.
Yeah.
Some other things, this is a tip for you. You know, especially going through the Old Testament, there's a lot of genealogies and it's just like so-and-so begot so-and-so begot so-and-so. I'll skip over some of that stuff unless we're going through a genealogy study or if there's something important that I want to point out to my kids when they're older. Mm-hmm. I might go back through that, but really I want to get to the main chunks of scripture. I just want to read stuff that they're going to remember, the main stories. I'm not going to skip over everything, but you know, if it's not super important to the flow of what we've been reading, I'll just jump right over. I don't want to make my kids hate me reading the Bible. And when they get older, that stuff will get more and more interesting and there'll be times that it's appropriate, but that's another way, just a tip for you. If you're wanting to just go chronologically, to think through the excitement of what you're reading.
Awesome. So we hope that by sharing a little bit of perspective and insight into how we study the Bible as a family, it would encourage and challenge you guys to also be pursuing diligently how to study the Bible as a family. And just know that a marriage after God is one that pursues this diligently.
And we just want to encourage you finally at the end of this, because it can get daunting.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know where to start. I don't know much about the Bible. How am I supposed to teach this to my kids? Well, the first encouragement is by doing it, you'll get more knowledgeable. Just opening it up and reading it.
The other one is to simplify it. Yeah. Don't like overwhelm yourself with the what ifs or the unknowns. Just start doing it and let it be a simple process.
Yeah. And lastly, we want to encourage you with this scripture.
Yeah, I'm going to read Hebrews 4, verse 12. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart.
So we want to encourage you that the word of God in itself is powerful.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't need me to make it sound more powerful. It doesn't need me to know it so deeply that I can make it more powerful. Mm-hmm. That's good that I learned that and then I can do that because the Bible tells me that I should be able to do that. But the Word of God, just reading it in our homes, is powerful.
Yeah.
That just by reading it, it could and will bring faith and knowledge and understanding to our kids.
Yeah, in Romans 10:17, it says, so faith comes from hearing and hearing through the word of Christ.
Yeah. So just reading it is a powerful thing and being diligent to read it out loud every day is huge. And then asking questions about it. And so just know that the Bible, the word of God, is powerful.
It's active and it's going to do the work for you. I mean, it's God. Yeah. It's him in his word that is going to do the work.
And you'll be surprised at how much it changes you. Mm-hmm. And how you'll start to learn more about it and you'll start to get into it and you'll be able to teach it to your children. So we just pray that this encouraged you today and inspired you in your own walks in your family and how you guys are going to navigate studying the Bible together, being diligent in it, teaching it to your kids when you sit down, when you walk by the way, when you lie down and rise up. And we just thank you for joining us today and we'll see you next week.
Did you enjoy today's show? If you did, it would mean the world to us if you could leave us a review on iTunes. Also, if you're interested, you can find many more encouraging stories and resources at marriageaftergod.com. And let us help you cultivate an extraordinary marriage.